This month's topic is Alexander Alekhine, and I'll get to the name in a moment. But again, presented by myself, I'm Lucas Anderson. If you don't know, I'm a librarian by day, and Warren Harper, who is a computer scientist by day, but by night we are rabid chess fans. And we hope we transmit that through this exploration of our topic tonight. Alekhine's name in Russian is pretty hard to pronounce. And we anglicize it, and people say, I've heard it pronounced Alekhine, 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 Alekhine. There's a ton of different ways to pronounce it, but the way Alekhine preferred it is just that way. And we know that from his friend and second in a couple of his tournaments, including the 1929 World Championship, Hans Kmoke, who we talked about last week, who relates a story in which Alekhine was offended when people would come up to him and say Alekhine or Alekhine. He thought it was a per Hans Kmoke, a Yiddish distortion of his last name. So we'll try to pronounce it as the world champion would have liked. He said, incidentally, that the reason it was pronounced Alekhine is because near or on one of his family's estates, a tree grew on that estate called Alyesha. And that's according to Hans Kmoke. And I talked to the Russian teacher at the school where I work, and I said, does that name ring a bell? And she said, well, the only thing I can think of is that tree up there, which is an alder tree. And you'll notice it's spelled somewhat similar to Alekhine's last name, but it's not spelled, and I won't even bother trying to pronounce it, but it's not pronounced exactly the same. The only thing I could find, incidentally, for Alyesha was, Alyesha is a nickname for the Russian first name Alexei, and Alexander's brother was named Alexei. So I don't know if he was having a little bit of fun with Mr. Kmoke or what, but when he was a child, he was often called Tisha by his family and then Shura later by his wife. So you may encounter those names in your readings. But for our purposes, when he moved to France in 1921, he wrote his name as Alexander Alekhine, which is the way we will try to pronounce it. Now, Alekhine was born into a very wealthy family. His father, in fact, was a also named Alexander, was a marshal of nobility. Basically, he was the governor of a region of Russia called Voronezh, and Voronezh was similar to a state. So we could think of him as essentially a state governor appointed by Tsar Nicholas II. So this is a family that had ins with the monarchy and who were members of the nobility. They were landowners. Between Alekhine's father owned 5 estates, his mother owned 2 and shares of a textile mill. So they certainly came from money. The father was a very kind of hands-off father. He wasn't around very much. He had duties to attend to, and the family lived mostly in Moscow, but the father spent most of his time in Voronezh, which is south on the border with Ukraine. And so young Alexander didn't see his father very much. He actually learned chess from his mother. So there we have the father and the mother, Mother Agnesa Prokhorova, who was also a very wealthy person in her own right. She owned shares of the textile mill and 2 other estates. Here we have a family portrait when Alekhine was 9 years old. He was born in 1892. And you'll see him on the far right with Alexei, his brother, just to his left. Alekhine learned chess both from his mother, like I mentioned, and the mother gave him his first chess set, but also from his brother. His brother was a pretty strong player in his own right, played in a lot of amateur tournaments, never made it to the master level. And so Alexander surpassed his brother around the age of 10. He started learning chess around the age of 7. And this chess was an obsession for young Alexander throughout his life, really. There are stories that I've encountered where he was in school, like taking a geometry test, and he would stand up and exclaim, "I have it!" And the teacher would say, "What do you have?" And he would say, "White sacrifices the knight and wins." And that wasn't exactly conducive to doing well in the geometry test. And yet, Alekhine was a strong chess player. It's funny, his parents had to take away his chess set at night, or else he'd stay up by candlelight, studying intently and playing through positions. And his chess teacher and his teachers at school had to forbid him from having a set with them at school. So, but his friends could have sets. So Alekhine in elementary school learned to play blindfold chess and pass notes to his friends with his moves, and they'd pass notes back and forth in class. So he skirted around the adult's best efforts to repress him. Now, at the time when he was young, it was not common for a young child to go to a chess club. You know, these days, children can go to chess clubs and take lessons from whomever and participate in tournaments. It was not the case in Russia at the turn of the century. So what Alekhine did was he played a lot of correspondence games, and he started playing correspondence games in 1902. This was at the age of 10. In 1902, he got his first taste of the Moscow Chess Club. He watched his older brother play in a simultaneous exhibition with Henry Nelson Pillsbury, actually the American player. And his brother, incidentally, got a draw in that simul. And that really got Alekhine wanting to play competitive chess. So he started playing correspondence games, the only thing open to him. And he also started getting lessons at home from various chess masters. One name I encountered was Fyodor Duzhotomirsky, which you probably haven't heard of him, but he's the guy who gave the Sicilian dragon its name, because he said it looks like a dragon, and from then on it's called the dragon. So he was tutored by some very strong chess players in his own right, and he became a very good correspondence player. And at the first opportunity he had to play in an amateur tournament in 1908 at the age of 16, he won it. He won the Moscow City Championship, and then the following year he won the All-Russia Amateur Championship, which gave him obviously a reputation as a strong player. He got hit this vase from Tsar Nicholas II himself. Most chess players I read would sell the vase and, you know, take the money and run, essentially. But Alekhine actually kept up with this vase for decades when he immigrated from Russia later on in the 1920s. That was the only thing he took with him, clothes on his back and his darn vase. So he was proud of it. And rightfully so, actually. This vase was made in a factory in France where Auguste Rodin, the famous French sculptor, worked. So it may have been, you know, influenced by Rodin. So quite a valuable one. It had the royal seal on it, everything. But it gave Alekhine the opportunity to play in master-level tournaments. He was now officially a master by the word of the Tsar himself. And so he shifted then from amateur to master-level play. And his brother remained in the amateur bracket. And because of this, he was able to travel and play internationally. Here he is playing against Capablanca in 1913. I may have mentioned it last month in the Nimcevich lecture, but Capablanca was Cuban, but he was named a Cuban ambassador to Russia, partly so that he could compete in Europe, because otherwise Cuba and Europe are quite separated. And so Alekhine had the chance to play against Capablanca on several occasions, and Alekhine knew that Capablanca was going to be the strongest player in the world. It was Emmanuel Lasker, who was world champion in 1913 and had been for 10 plus years at this point. But Alekhine knew even then that one day it was going to be Capablanca, and so he had his sights set on him, if you will. You'll also notice the uniform Alekhine is wearing. He often wore that between 1912 and 1916 because he was enrolled in a law school for nobles in St. Petersburg. So he often wore kind of a military style uniform, if you will. So at the tender age of 22, Alekhine participated, this is in 1914, in the St. Petersburg Invitational, had a fairly strong field, as you can see. And the top five finishers of this tournament were deemed by Tsar Nicholas II to be grandmasters of chess. So they were the original grandmasters of chess. There was no FIDE, there was no rating guidelines, it was just your tournament results. And the top five players, which includes some very, very big names, included Alekhine, and he became one of the original grandmasters at the tender age of 22. Obviously, nobody was younger than him when this happened. To give you a taste of his early chess, Let's go ahead and look at one of his first games he played. This was in, or that first game of the evening for us, rather. This was played in 1915. We think the opponent was Grigoriev, but the NN there stands for no name. We're not entirely sure. This was played after the outbreak of World War I, so, you know, information from this time period is a little bit sketchy. And for that, I will turn it over to Warren.
Thanks, Lucas.
Yeah, so this game actually probably did not actually happen. It probably just became, through gossip, something that actually did. So I'll give you a couple of quotes. So in Alekhine's games, what's it, My Best Games of Chess, he says, this was a game played by the author in Moscow. But earlier in, I think it was 1916, in a Russian magazine, he says, one possible fantastic variation is, and he gives a game. So it turned from earlier from one possible fantastic variation to an actual game. So I'm going to pin this to ego in terms of him saying it was against Grigoriev. But even if it wasn't real, it's still pretty awesome. And actually, before I start the first game, I kind of want to give an account of what he was like by, I think it was a Venetian newspaper. Yes, by the Vienna Press, I'm sorry. So here's a quote the newspaper gives of his account. This was in, what year was this? 1922, so this would have been a few years after that. Anyway, it says, Alekhine is the embodiment of nervousness. The facial expression of this tall, elegant young man is constantly changing. The impulsive movements of his hands, with which he first passes impetuously through his light gingery hair, then quickly picks up pieces that have been removed from the board. All this reflects the intense, passionate working of his mind. After his every move, he quickly stands up. With rapid, impetuous steps, his elegant figure moves from board to board, and with a keen glance, he takes in the positions in the games. If his opponent succeeds in putting him in a difficult position with an unexpected maneuver, he becomes irritable and impatient. The slightest noise gets on his nerves. His bright eyes are fixed searchingly on his opponent, as though with the aim of penetrating into his thoughts. And when he finds a good reply, a triumphant smile lights up his face. The board at which he is playing is always surrounded by a dense crowd of spectators. Anyway, that was kind of a long aside, but I kind of, that paints a picture of what he was like, I think. So this guy was no poker player. He did not really try to hide his emotions. So I think it's kind of interesting. So just imagine a really nervous, fidgety guy playing this game that may or may not have actually happened. Anyway, so we'll get started. So this opening is called McCutcheon Variation. And here he played, nowadays, which is not very much in fashion, taking on f6. More common nowadays would be a move like bishop e3 or bishop d2. There was a famous Fischer game as well. But at the time, they were still exploring this theory. There were some interesting lines. So at this point, at the time, it was not known, but simply queen f6 here just equalizes for black, just picking up his pawn on g7 and not bothering with counterplaying the center. But at the time, they were more ambitious, I guess you could say, or just didn't know. And so bishop e7 was played to maintain this pawn on h4. But it's much more complicated after g3. So, by the way, this line is playable for black. It's just unnecessarily complicated, essentially. All right. And here is where black has an improvement. So instead of playing queen takes a2 like he did, he can play, what was it? Bishop f8, I think, is the move. The whole point is to try to pick up this pawn on g7. I think, where did my analysis go? Okay, yeah. So bishop f8 with the idea of if h7, then just rook takes g7. And although white can queen, black is going to take on a2 and wins material here as well. So let's go back. So my queen takes. We already have this ridiculousness happening. By the way, surprisingly, both sides are playing pretty well. There really isn't much room for improvement. And finally, we have this position after b1 queen, where we have five queens on the board. And it's not very often you see a game like this. Alekhine had another famous game with Capablanca with four queens, but this trumps even that. And here, actually, he remarkably found the strongest move here for white, even back then, without help of computers, which is pretty incredible. So if you want to try to look at this for a second and see if you can find white's move here. Queen d8, I think knight takes.
Queen b6, yeah. Well, then he would just come back out.
Yeah, if queen d8, knight takes, queen d6, knight c6. Simple position, right?
Maybe queen c7 check.
So queen c7, I think he can just take it.
Oh, queen takes
d5. I think the problem with that is the black would take on e3.
Queen h6.
What's your idea?
Right. It seems like he's improving. I mean, it's the only thing that's not doing anything, it seems like, except the knight.
Yeah.
The bishop's taking away the b6, or b5 and a6 squares. The knight and the rook are the only things that aren't really doing anything.
And that gives you d8, too.
So, wow, that's pretty incredible. Yeah, that's actually what he, played. I say played in quotes. Yeah. He found, I would rather say, rook h6. Yeah, remarkably, it's actually the best move. So,
sorry, repeat explanation again? What?
For why rook h6?
Yeah.
I don't know, can you repeat what your thought process was?
Well, my process was, I was looking at, what pieces aren't really doing anything? The bishop's doing something by taking a couple squares away from the king as far as the b5 and a6 squares. The queens are in the middle, two of them are in the middle of the board, the other one is stretching across that A2 G8 diagonal. So the only thing that's not really doing anything is that knight right there on G1 and the rook. I figured line up the rook on the queen. Or I'm sorry, line up the rook on the king.
Yeah. You took kind of I would call it like Nimzowitchian approach to the position, right? Trying to make that piece better. Alekhine explained it much differently. He was just thinking rook H6 threatens queen D8 and mates. So, well, it's mate in one, actually, right? So that was his logic, a way of finding it. How can I threaten mate in one? Oh, this does. Must be right. that kind of gives you a clue into how he thinks. He was very, very concrete in that respect. But yeah, so, and rook h6 is, by the way, black does have a move that makes things kind of tough for white, but just to look at some obvious replies, if black takes on e3, then white plays queen d8. King c5, queen fd6, king d4, and queen f6, and mates, right, knight e5, queen takes. So bishop takes e3, loses. Now another reasonable reply would be queen takes f1, but this also loses. Maybe someone wants to take a stab. I think it's pretty crazy. Like, all the... What? Yeah, I think that's a pretty awesome move to make. Just pins everywhere.
Interesting.
Yeah. And if king c7, well, if queen b5, then queen d8, king a6, and then finally queen a3. Pretty neat variation, just pieces everywhere. not a position you see every day. So queen b5 fails, and if king c7, then we have queen g3 check. And white wins here.
This is not a real game.
But it could have been. I think this tortured Alekhine that this didn't happen. I think that's why he later said, in a game played by the author in his book, I think he wanted this to be a game. Kasparov specifically mentions that he thinks it happened via gossip. Like, oh, I was analyzing this position with Grigoriev, and all of a sudden it turned into Alekhine's game with Grigoriev. So he played on the fact that people were gossiping. But, yeah, anyway, this game is just pretty awesome. So I had never seen this game until I was looking for cool games from him. But, yeah, that's all I had for this one.
All right, so we saw with Nimcevich that World War I was a big disruption to his playing career. This was also true for Alekhine. He was actually playing in Mannheim, Germany, when Germany declared war against Russia. This was in August of 1914. He was leading the Mannheim tournament, actually. He was up a pretty substantial amount, and then Germany declared war and said, oh, Russian chess players, come with us, we're putting you in prison. And so he was actually transported to various places, and like there's an incident where one time his train was stopped because they had the train conductor thought there were suspicious Russians on board, and there were him and about 8 other chess players, and they were beat up in the streets, and then they were transferred to a jail in Baden-Baden, interestingly enough, because Alekhine played a tournament later there in 1925, and they were incarcerated there for several days. And in this time, they didn't actually. It's funny because Alekhine was in the same cell, it's kind of a hotel room. Moreover, they put him in fairly nice accommodations for prisoners, because they were still prestigious prisoners. They were all not only internationally renowned chess players, but most of them were from very wealthy families. He was put in a cell with Bogolyubov, and they played blindfold chess for hours and hours and hours, because that's all they could do to occupy themselves. Well, Alekhine was released. He made his way in a very circuitous roundabout way back to Moscow. He originally went to Italy because he had a match scheduled with Capablanca in Buenos Aires, and he thought maybe he could make it to Argentina. He couldn't, so he had to take a really circuitous route back to like England and then Finland and then back to Russia. Made it back to Russia in October, and the first thing he started doing was he played simultaneous exhibitions for all the Russian prisoners who had not yet secured release. And so he tried to raise money, essentially, to get them to be released from Baden-Baden. So it was a nice gesture. Later on, he enlisted in the army as a member of the nobility. He was essentially made an officer instantaneously, and he was put in charge of a dressing station or a, you know, kind of a field hospital on the front with Germany. He was spent most of his time at the time in Poland, in present-day Ukraine, and he was twice hospitalized himself for shell shock, what we call nowadays combat stress reaction, you know, typified by the thousand-yard stare that we see in our patient on the slide. And so he was twice decorated for his service, actually thrice decorated for his service, so he became a war hero. And he spent quite a bit of time convalescing, you know, recovering from shell shock. And while he was there, you know, in the hospital, he was playing chess also. So even when he was unfit for duty, he was still doing blindfold simultaneous expos in the field hospital. And then he was, once the war and the hostilities concluded, he returned to Moscow. Unfortunately, Moscow was in a turbulent state because in October of 1917, we had the Bolshevik Revolution. And you may remember from our lecture on Nimcevich that the Bolshevik Revolution was very unfavorable to the nobility, to the merchant class, those with money. Bolshevik, incidentally, in Russian means the majority. And so what this was an uprising of the majority, or the people who were disenfranchised. In other words, the farmers, primarily, against the nobility. Alekhine's father was a member of the nobility. And so his father, His mother actually died in 1915 of, we think, natural causes, but his father was executed in 1917 by the Bolsheviks, and their properties were seized. So all of their estates, the five estates from his father's side, the two estates from his mother's side, the textile mill, they were all seized and utilized by the communist regime however they wanted. And Alekhine just had to essentially suck it up and deal with it. As a member of a former member of the nobility, because he was left fairly destitute, he was always under suspicion as a potential White Russian. You know it as a cocktail, but it's also a name of a Russian who supported the monarchy, as opposed to a Red Russian, those who supported the Communist Party. And so he was suspected of being a White Russian sympathizer and maybe even a spy. There's an anecdote where he traveled to the Ukraine in 1919, which was part of the Russian Empire then, to the town of Odessa, not Texas, but Russia. And he played in a tournament there, and he was arrested. He was staying in a hotel, and he was arrested, and they suspected that he was a spy, and so he was imprisoned, and he was almost actually executed by firing squad. There was a order for his execution which was written, and a clerk in the office saw it across his desk, recognized the name, and this clerk, whose name is Yakov Vilner, happened to be one of the strongest chess players in the Ukraine at the time, and he called up the head of the secret police, or the Cheka, in the Ukraine at the time, and said, wait a second, this is Alekhine, this is the Russian champion. And they essentially got a stay of execution for him, because otherwise he was essentially a day away from being executed by a firing squad. And what made it so hard when researching this is that this isn't always talked about, particularly by Russian authors. In this book by Kotov, who was a strong grandmaster in his own right, and a Russian player, he doesn't really address this. He says, we have almost no information about the life and affairs of Alekhine during the stormy days of the revolution. According to an eyewitness, the Moscow chess player Iglitsky told me about this. Alekhine was in Odessa in 1917, actually 1919, from where it was said he was intending to go abroad. Then he changed his mind and once again was to be seen in Moscow. In any case, among his surviving games, there are some played at this time against Moscow chess players. So it's like, there's no mention of the fact that he almost, you know, was executed by a firing squad. And so this was kind of swept under the rug, because this is kind of a dark chapter in the history of Russia, because there were, you know, in the Leninist and Stalinist purges to follow, there were hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of people who were executed, including Tsar Nicholas II and his family, and who were shipped off to prison camps. So Alekhine had to keep a low profile. He tried to get a couple of jobs. He had his, you know, he was essentially an attorney. He worked for his brother for a bit in a hospital. He worked as a criminal investigator, relying on his law degree. And then he was a translator for Comintern, which was the organization Lenin founded, and whose purpose was to spread communism internationally. And it's in this capacity that he was able to get out of Paris. He essentially married a woman who was from Switzerland, and because of that, he was able to get an exit visa. And so in 1921, Alekhine fled to Paris, and he went from a very dark place in, you know, 1921 Moscow, particularly for the nobility, to Paris, which at this time was a cultural and artistic center. You know it from the lost generation of authors, like we have, let's see, going around. This is Marc Chagall. He was a Russian emigre artist. This is Rachmaninoff, the famous composer and pianist. Hemingway, Gertrude Stein, James Joyce, F. Scott Fitzgerald, and Igor Stravinsky. These people were all living in Paris at the time, and several of them, including Rachmaninoff, Stravinsky, and Chagall, were Russian emigres who had fled Russia, just like Alekhine did. So he found some kinship in Paris. He found a new home, which is good, because he never returned to Russia ever again. There's no mention of him ever returning to Russia after October of 1921. And he thrived during this period. His, you know, he was able to play chess, he was able to play bridge, he was able, that was his second passion, by the way, was bridge. He went to balls and dinners and concerts and conferences, and he was well liked by society there, although some suspected him of selling out some of the white Russians to get clemency himself. There's no allegation, there's no corroboration of that, but it was suspected. And he was well liked by the media as well, funnily enough, he referred to as the profanes, because they didn't understand what an art chess was, but he was patient with them nonetheless. He stayed in Paris for most of the rest of his life. He became a French citizen in 1927, incidentally during his world championship match against Capablanca, to which most people jokingly said, Capablanca, it's the only time in history that a Cuban has faced a Russian in a chess championship, and the Cuban lost to a Frenchman, because he became a Frenchman by the end of the championship. So this takes us to our second game, which is a fairly it's a fairly short little position that we have. This game was played, we think, in 1917 in St. Petersburg, before Alekhine immigrated. All right.
So we don't really have the full game. This is just one of Alekhine's favorite positions that he includes in his book. I'm not sure if it's just something he remembers from memory or if he just doesn't actually have the full game. But anyway, before I continue with this game, I want to give kind of Kasparov's... I'll plagiarize his theory of chess and something he says about Alekhine. So... one of the things Alekhine was really good at was thriving in these complicated positions like the one above. And Kasparov explains it in the context of the different advantages you have in chess. And he gives three, which is material, the one most people are familiar with, right? You have an extra pawn, you have an extra knight, something like that. And time is the other one, as in your king's in danger, so you sacrifice a piece, gives you more time to attack your opponent's king. That's like an example of time, that factor. Or if you're racing pawn storms, time is important there. You might sacrifice a piece just to have an extra move or two. And the other factor, and one that Kasparov says Alekhine was very, very good at, was quality of position. So what that means is your pawn structure is superior, your pieces are better placed, your opponent's king is weak, something like that. So just for example, in this position, the advantage white has is that black's king is pretty weak here. It can't even move, for example. White's king is also not very safe, but comparatively it is. And so anyway, Alekhine was just extremely good operating in these kind of dynamic, complicated positions where things didn't always add up. Tall is very comparative, is very easily comparable with Alekhine in this respect, but the difference is that with Tall, many of his sacrifices were purely intuitive, but Alekhine, he was very concrete. He always had a very specific reason for sacrificing, and the positions he managed to create were just something that his opponents could not really understand. He created such imbalances where you would give up huge amounts of material just for a better position, and at that time, many of the players were just not ready for this development. So anyway, that's plagiarizing Kasparov quite a bit, but I think it's interesting anyway. So anyway, we'll start with the first move. So by the way, in this position, he did manage to win this, but his position is not exactly winning here. But he starts out by creating a complication. So he plays c5. Many people might play this anyway, just trying to open up the queen side. I don't know if white actually had a better move, but it's a good try. Yeah. So it's probably his best shot. And black played b5. This turned out to not really be such... Let me get my notes, actually. Turns out to not be such a great idea. Oh, you put it in the book? Okay. All right. Yeah, so here b5 is okay. A better move would have been instead rook e2. And this actually leads to, essentially, black gets a winning endgame. although that's a long variation, I won't really go into it. It's not too relevant. But the main point I want to make by showing this move is that Black only has, despite this material advantage, only one move that gives him anything. And the other move which leads to a draw is knight e4. And I think this is mainly because Black gets to trade queens.
You could force perpetual.
No, actually.
Oh, interesting.
So, yeah, the problem with knight f1, and I'll actually give this variation, Kasparov and Elie can both analyze this. So, check, knight g3. The problem is that White can just take it.
Rook can take.
Yeah. And then after queen takes, just takes b6. If, for example, rook takes c. Oh, wait. Yeah, okay. Yes, it is, but unfortunately, if queen takes d6, White has rook takes c8, queen b8, and b7 check. And White wins this endgame after bishop c5. So, yeah. Highly unfortunate, right? But yeah, so unfortunately, this actually does not work for Black. So I don't know if he actually saw this in the game or not, but he may have. But yeah, anyways, the only move to win is rook e2, and knight e4 is the other move, which draws. So that just goes to show you how complicated this position is. And anyway, so he played b5, and I think now it's rather difficult for Black, but it's just fun to watch what happens here. So now, instead of, well, the queen doesn't have a lot of squares anyway, but he just plays b6. And this wall of pawns approaching the black king creates quite a nice impression. So yeah, here it's already a difficult situation. White's threatening rook takes c8, and if, for example, rook takes c2, anybody want to give a shot at what White plays?
B7.
Okay, b7, and then say king d8. Yeah, bishop takes, and then queen, and then White mates, right? Yeah, so rook takes. Okay, yeah, I'll analyze it. I'm sorry, I shouldn't skip over. So king b8, White captures on a7. King takes, now queen. King takes is forced again. Okay, does anybody want to point out the mate? I think it's... Yeah, queen b5 I think is simplest, right? Queen b5, king a7, queen a4, bishop a5, and mate. Yeah, I think mate in 3 is... It's probably the shortest way there. But yeah, so this is not possible for Black. The other possibility, which I think... Oh man. Unfortunately, I did not write down the analysis, but it turns out the move that was best for trying to hold on was actually bishop c7.
Obviously.
Yeah, obviously, right? You just hang your piece that can be taken by two pawns, right? But yeah, I don't remember the full analysis, but every line is basically pretty to look at here. But the finish of this is just fun to watch, even. So rook c7, b7. King b8, and now this is a really cool move. I don't know if I would ever see this in a long game, even.
Bishop takes
a7? Nope.
D7?
Yeah, d7. It creates quite an impression. It's very pretty. White is down a full queen here, but yet the two pawns in the seventh rank is just irresistible. There's nothing Black can do. The point is that if rook takes d7, there's just mate in 1, and White's threatening b takes c8 queen, which is just mate, and that threat is just unavoidable. And in the game, I think he played queen g3, and then he just booted king back. Doesn't even need to take it. So, yeah, this is a very, very beautiful position. I think it really, it kind of hammers in what Kasparov was saying about handling these positions with such imbalances. Even though White's missing a full queen in material, these two pawns on the seventh rank just represent a huge advantage in quality of position. King safety, and that's the relevant feature here. So that's a really fun final position to look at. But yeah, that's all I had for that game.
So I talked a little bit about Alekhine's marriages. Let me elaborate on that in a little more detail. Alekhine was married four times. The first, and before I go any further, I should say that Alekhine was teased, and perhaps rightfully so, for his love of older women. Alasker said that at the Scheveningen tournament in 1913, that they, at the end of the tournament, the festivities concluded, you know, there was music and dancing, and Alekhine would only dance with one woman who was twice his age, and according to Lasker, twice his circumference. So maybe he had a little mommy thing going on, I'm not sure, but he certainly, every wife that he married was an older woman, and most of them were fairly rotund. So anyway, we'll get into the first marriage, which did not last very long at all, was with a woman named Anna von Surigen. Like, she was a Russian, a member of the nobility. They were married in 1920, and the only real reason they married was to legitimize their illegitimate daughter, who was born in 1913. I guess she had a fling with him, with the very young Alekhine. He was 21 at the time. She was married. Her husband died in World War I. They married at the in 1920 to legitimize the daughter, Valentina, who was born in 1913. But Alekhine was not a very hands-on father at all. He wasn't really there for his children. His dad wasn't really around when he was a kid, and I don't know if that had something to do with it, but he had other things to do, and chess was foremost among them. So they actually separated just a few months later, but there's no record that they actually divorced. Instead, Alekhine got engaged again in December 1920, the same year he married his first wife, to Annelise Reg. She was a member of a Swiss delegation she was a journalist and a member of like the International Red Cross, and she actually interviewed Lenin. And Alekhine met her because he was a translator for Comintern at the time. Alekhine had gained fluency in French and in German as a child, and so he was used as an interpreter. They met and married, and at the time, Alekhine was 28 and his wife was 41. Annelise actually became pregnant as well with Alekhine's son, Alexander, another Alexander. So the father's, Alekhine's father's Alexander, you know, the first, and Alekhine's junior, and then his son was Alexander the third. And his son was born in 1922. Annelise left Alekhine and moved back to Switzerland. That's where she wanted to raise their child. Alekhine didn't follow, but by marrying a foreign woman, he was able to obtain an exit visa. And some say he did this intentionally. It was a calculated move on his part to get out of Russia. And so he obtained his exit visa. He fled to Paris. Annelise went to Switzerland. They saw each other a few times after that, but they were divorced in 1924. In 1924, when he got divorced because he met another woman. That's in the top right picture. Her name was Nadezhda or Natasha Semenyovna, and she was a war widow as well. Her husband had died in the war. She was a member of a Russian family, older than Alekhine. I don't know exactly how much older, but Grunfeld, you know, who we know from the defense, estimated her age to be between 70 and 80. So she wasn't that old, but Grunfeld was like, you know, thought she looked ancient. And Nadine was, as the people in Paris called her, was a very polite, very proper, you know, noble woman who Incidentally, the waiters and restaurants labeled her the Christmas tree because she wore a ton of jewelry, but she was very nice, we hear. And Alekhine stayed with her until 1932, when he left her for another woman. In the last photo, we have Grace Wishart, who's also, we sometimes see spelled Wishart, like with a D or a T at the end, who was also a widow. Her husband had been a general in the English army, so she was an American with English citizenship because she had lived in England, and she was living in Paris, and she owned an estate, a castle, really, in Normandy. And actually, she was pretty good at chess. Alekhine met her at a simul. This is Grace, met her at a simul, and she asked him to sign one of her books, or one of his books, afterward, and then soon he left Nadine for Grace, and he maintained for the rest of his life, because they stayed married, that Grace was the only one who understood him. And Grace, incidentally, won the French Women's Championship in 1944. So she was a fairly strong player in her own right, but she was much older than Alekhine also. She had a daughter who was almost Alekhine's age when they got married, so another matronly figure. Unfortunately, the wives could not control a recurring theme through Alekhine's life, which was alcoholism. In fact, Grace, the fourth wife, was an alcoholic herself, and probably contributed to Alekhine's deterioration into alcoholism, and we'll see later on that he suffered from that. And also, people made fun of Grace's age also. Grunfeld said that Nadine looked like she was between 70 and 80. Grace, the chess circles in Paris called her La Veuve de Philidor, the widow of Philidor. Philidor died in the 1700s. So she was pretty old too. She was 58 when they married, and Alekhine was 42. So there was a 16-year gap there. But, you know, they provided him with what he wanted, which was stability. They freed him up from household duties and worrying about, you know, this, that, and the other, so that he could go out and play bridge and play chess and travel internationally to tournaments and, you know, drink and party and do what he wanted. So they freed him up to do that. Now, I mentioned that Capablanca had dethroned Lasker to win the world championship, and Alekhine had distinguished himself through tournament results, so it was widely expected that the two of them would face off in the world championship. Now, under the system at the time, which are called the London Rules, which were ratified in 1922 and signed by Alekhine and Bogoliubov and Lasker and Capablanca and all the other notable players at the time, Alekhine had to meet certain conditions to create a world championship match. First, they had to have a purse of $10,000, which doesn't sound much now, but with inflation, it was a lot of money. And they had to raise a purse that would cover the travel expenses and the lodging expenses of both players. So that was a pretty significant amount. The onus was on the challenger. It's not like FIDE accepting bids and not getting any bids. The challenger had to raise the money to actually challenge for that championship. And the way it was structured, the winner would get 20% as an appearance fee. And then, you know, the reigning champion would get 20% as an appearance fee, win or lose. And then the winner of the tournament would get 40% of the prize purse. 50% of the prize purse, and the loser would get 30% of the prize purse. So, like, no matter what, the champion was going to get half the money, right? If not more. So they had to raise all that money to make the championship happen, and it happened in 1927. And Alekhine won that championship with a score of 6 wins, 3 losses, and 25 draws. Lots of draws, that was what Capablanca was known for. And so it took 34 games, and this was in Buenos Aires. You may remember that they had the match in Buenos Aires in 1914 that Alekhine couldn't attend because he was trapped in Europe. So the chess club and government of Buenos Aires kind of collaborated to get the money together to make that championship happen. And And Alekhine went, and he, much to the surprise of pretty much everybody, because everybody thought Capablanca was unbeatable, Alekhine won. So let's look at our third game and see how he was able to do that.
Yeah, there are a lot of good Alekhine Capablanca games, like I mentioned earlier, the four queens game he had, but this was one of his personal favorites, so... And I think it kind of showcases the difference in how he thought compared to that time. So let's take a look. So exciting openings were not really a thing back then. So we have typical Queen's Gambit decline. Not that they're necessarily a thing now. Like Berlin defense is common now. But nonetheless, this is pretty stagnant. They repeated this kind of opening many times throughout the match. Alekhine with black scored very nicely. I don't think he ever lost a game with black in this World Championship match. This move A6 is kind of interesting. It's not really in fashion nowadays, but he was really a big fan of this back then, probably because people did not really know how to respond to it very well. Capablanca responded with A3, which is pretty meek. Nowadays, any grandmaster would play C5 without much hesitation. Okay, the idea that A6, the value of which is somewhat doubtful, because it's kind of a waste of time, because you would like to play C6, B6, and break up these queenside pawns. But this move is just very slow. So anyway, he played A3. We won't bash on Capablanca for not knowing this. But black quickly takes over an initiative here. Now, one subtle point here. Alekhine played bishop b7 in many, many games, but turns out this is a pretty significant inaccuracy. C5 right away here is definitely the most precise. The point is that if bishop b7, the best move is just b4. Trying to create this bind on the c-pawn so black cannot free his position so easily. Alekhine gave the line a5, but after queen b3, takes... Knight d5, he really does not evaluate this position correctly. Here he says black is doing well, but Kasparov points out that white can just castle, and white's position is by no means bad at all here. Because black is going to be saddled with this weak c-pawn if, for example, he takes on b4. But anyway, that's an aside, just opening accuracies. So Capablanca just castled. Now c5. And this is kind of a cool point here. So Capablanca was really expecting knight e4 here. And I don't know who was commentating at the time, but Kasparov mentions they were also looking at this. But knight d7 is a much stronger move, and the reason is pretty much simple. It keeps pieces on the board. And the other point here is, of course, that the knight is heading for a specific square, hopefully, and that's c4. C4 is somewhat easier for black to take advantage than white's analogous square on c5. Black has a lot more pieces on that than white has on c4. So already, black has a pretty nice advantage going for him. So, anyway, so let's continue. And this was another move that Capablanca was not expecting. So he was expecting just knight c4 instead, trying to target a3, threaten knight d2. But again, it's not really as good because white can just take on d5. Rook c4 is kind of counterintuitive since you'd want to put the knight there in general in this kind of situation, right? Because the rook doesn't really target anything. But the main point is that he'd like to try to get this queen over to a8 and then play rook fc8. It just creates a nice coordination for black. And, you know, this concreteness that Alekhine had, instead of improving his position, instead of playing the obvious move, just improving his pieces, he looks for a deeper plan with specific moves, and this was kind of upsetting for Capablanca. Not being able to predict your opponent's moves is a kind of a psychological loss if you're the guy playing against it. I've experienced that a couple times, not very many, and one of those was when I played Nakamura. I just could not predict his moves. It is pretty upsetting psychologically. So even though White's position isn't that bad, I kind of understand why Kappa falls apart kind of quickly. If you just consistently don't predict your opponent's moves, it makes it hard to feel confident in yourself. So the Black Queen goes to a8. Now White's still trying to exchange pieces, but Black just continues to strengthen his position. And okay, here Black's position is not really that hugely advantageous. White could have played f3, and White has some chances of holding on with the idea of just playing bishop f2. But already it's kind of hard to handle, and Capablanca did not really see what Alekhine had in mind after a4. There's some pretty variations here. One tactical idea he plays on is weakness of this back rank. If you might notice, White's king is not exactly in a good situation there. So, trying to just attack a knight on d4. Capablanca was also not expecting this, because this moves the bishop away from attacking the weakness on b4. So again, he failed to predict what Alekhine was up to. And this move is pretty cool. It's not really something I would ever consider in this position. It doesn't really make sense, because you're just attacking the rook, and you're making your knight immobile, so to speak, because White would just take your bishop in that case. But it's really cool how he finds this move, simply because White's rook has no good squares. Now, if, for example, White plays rook d1, Black can play b takes a4, and then knight b6, and then Black gets this nice endgame here. White's rook just has such few squares. But unfortunately, Black's going to round up this b4 pawn. Just for example, something like this. And Black wins the pawn, and then it's just a case of converting after that. So this is one possible variation. Another interesting possibility, he could have tried rook b1. So if instead he had tried that, Black has a nice move here, if you guys want to try to look at it. Guys, want any hints? The back rank is pretty weak here. I think rook d8 gives White some time, and yeah. if queen e4, I think White can take on b2. I'm not entirely sure, actually, but. Now he has this cool move here, knight a3. Kind of ridiculous, right? So the idea is that if White takes on d5, then Black just takes back, and then Black wins a4, because White cannot take the bishop. And the other idea is that if queen takes b2, Black takes, and then he has a pretty clever move here.
A2 or queen a2?
Queen a2, that's an interesting variation. That probably also works well. Alekhine gives queen b3.
Queen a2 or queen
b1? It looks pretty similar, actually, because if queen d1, I think Black can play queen b2 here, and this still looks pretty strong. Rook c1 looks pretty hard to defend against. I'm sorry?
Bishop
d6. Bishop d6?
Oh, no.
Yeah, I think rook c1 looks pretty irresistible here. So yeah, I guess queen e2 actually also wins. But yeah, that the idea was say something like queen d3, queen f1, ba4, and then black just marches the a pawn. Yeah. So even despite the two pieces here, the a pawn is the decisive factor. So yeah, these concrete threats were not something Capablanca was used to having to calculate. Alekhine was just very concrete. These moves, like he played bishop b2, it made it very difficult for him. Anyway, he played rook e1, which is the best defense, but still falls short. So rook d8 takes h3, and now white's running out of squares for his pieces. White's really going to become displaced here. So knight d4 is a blunder, but already it is kind of difficult to say to suggest anything better. Knight e1 was probably a better idea, but it's still looking pretty dismal. Oh, whoops. I skipped. Yeah. So knight d4, he just takes, and then unfortunately, this pin does not work, because black reveals a discovery on the queen. So if, for example, queen takes d5, and black just takes, and black has his check if he takes back. So unfortunately, it's lights out. So yeah, I really like this game because it seems like Alekhine won almost out of nothing. I mean, Capablanca didn't make anything. That was an obvious mistake. He just kept applying pressure and forcing Capablanca to try to be resourceful, and he just couldn't handle it here. Yeah, this is one of his favorite games. Okay, that's all I had.
So with that match win, Alekhine becomes world champion, and with that, he gains, you know, financial resources. He gains the status. You know, he's at the pinnacle of his career, and he retains his world championship in his first title defense in 1929 against Bogolyubov, and that was actually pretty easy. In that match, Alekhine won 11, lost 5, and had 9 draws, so that's 15.5 to 9.5. And in that title, in that world championship match in 1929, they didn't follow the London rules. What they did, a modified version, it was the first player to 6 wins and over 15 points. So that's why Alekhine won 11 matches to his 5 losses before he actually became world champion, because he had to hit 15.5 points or higher as well to satisfy both winning conditions. And he did so with relative ease. It's also interesting to note that Alekhine played defense against Capablanca here, because from 1927 to 1936, Alekhine and Capablanca not only really, they never played a rated or a game in between that time period, and they pretty much never spoke either. They were not on amiable terms, and they avoided each other. In fact, Alekhine refused to participate in any tournament where Capablanca participated. So we saw in the Nimzowitsch lecture, Carlsbad 1927, and I said, well, Alekhine was there as a reporter because Capablanca was there as a competitor. And and I also talked about 1930, when Alekhine just demolished the competition by going 14 points out of 15, essentially, that Capablanca conspicuously is not present. Now, I remember Quenny asked last time, you know, what was his rating around that time, and there wasn't an official rating for these players because FIDE didn't exist and the ELO system didn't exist. But there's a website called Chess Metrics, and they go back and look at historical performances and try to put a number to them. And they say that Alekhine's strongest period was 1930 to 1931 in the Bled and Valdez tournaments, and that his performance rating at Bled in this tournament was estimated to be 2865, which is one of the strongest performance ratings of the 20th century. I think it's fifth or sixth highest. The highest was Fischer with like 2890, roughly, but very, very strong performance rating. And they estimate that his playing strength in 1931 overall was about 2851 in our current ELO system. And that was fifth best of the 20th century for 1 year time period, with Fischer and Kasparov leading that field. So very, very strong player in this time period, blowing away the competition, but conspicuously he did not play against Capablanca. Now, you may not know this, but Alekhine was also a very strong simul player. He set the record in 1924. He played a 26 board simultaneous blindfold match in New York, where he won 16, lost 5, and he drew 5 against what are considered to be some of the strongest opponents at the time. He was playing against some of the top players in New York City. So that was a very impressive performance, playing 26 matches blindfold simultaneously. It's pretty darn impressive to start with, but to do that well, even better. In 1925 in Paris, he played against 28 teams, and each team had 4 players, and they were able to collaborate on their moves. And in that match, Alekhine won 22, lost 3, and drew 3. He upped his previous result again in 1933 in Chicago, when he played 32 players simultaneously, where he won 19, lost 4, and drew 9. Incidentally, Emmanuel Lasker was a referee at that event, so he had passed his chess prime, but was still, you know, active in chess circles and was on amiable terms with Alekhine. I have here an article from Toronto 1932 where it promises that Alekhine is going to play 40 boards simultaneously blindfold. He did not play 40 boards. He did not have a record-breaking performance. I'm not sure how many he eventually played, but Chicago remains his highest number at 32. So he is not the best blindfold simul player of all time, but he's certainly way, way, way up there. And as a blindfold player, very, very strong. And we'll see a game later from Samish that he played blindfold. And it's pretty darn impressive. Now, as champion, he was somewhat quirky. He liked to drink. He liked to dance. He liked to party. And as a world champion, he was afforded certain accommodations that other players weren't allowed to have. So one of the things he liked to do is he liked to bring his cats along with him, and they would sit on his lap as he played chess. And you know, the other players couldn't really say much because he was the world champion, Dr. you know, Alekhine. Incidentally, the cats were not very good at chess. I black player there, their queenside development's terrible, and white can't even keep their pawns upright. But so it didn't spread to the cats. But he was okay. So he was pretty quirky about his habits, and you know, things had to be how he wanted. And the other players were pretty much accommodating because he was the best around. They sometimes grumbled about his eccentricities. Spielmann, the famous German player, wrote an open letter in which he criticized, you know, Alekhine's terms, like for rematches and for the way he was excluding Capablanca, but it didn't hold much sway. He also defended his title again in 1934, again against Bogolyubov, and that one was not close either. The match score for that one was Alekhine won with 8 wins, 3 losses, and 15 draws. So 15.5 to 10.5. So I guess a little bit closer than their first world championship. But again, he blew Bogolyubov away. 1935, however, was a slightly different story. Alekhine played, and this one's a hard one to pronounce. It's worse than Alekhine. It's Owe. Max Owe from the Netherlands. He was a mathematician and a teacher by training, by vocation, and a really strong chess player, actually. And this tournament was played in the Netherlands, which was home turf for Owe, and Owe actually won. He took the match off of Alekhine, and he took the world championship. It was very, very close, however. At the first, Alekhine went out to a commanding lead. At the end of game 9, the score stood 5 wins to Alekhine versus 2 losses and 2 draws. So he had a pretty huge lead, and he was looking like he was cruising to another title defense. But Owe adapted, worked his butt off, and turned it around. And by the end, Owe won the match, 9 wins to 8 losses and 13 draws. So a very close match, but a resounding defeat for the world champion. And I thought it would be kind of cool to play for you a video clip from this time period. This is a kind of news coverage, if you will, of the 1935 championship. This is the first game between Alekhine and Owa, and I'll just play a portion of this. I've got a link to the full video on YouTube if you're interested in the credits. Just a sec. For this particular one, let me go ahead and unmute it. There's a little bit of, because we hear both players speaking a little later on, and that's pretty cool. So this was the first match, and it starts off with Alekhine playing queen's pawn. I'll back it up just a little bit so you can see how gracefully he moves. The little pinky in the air and everything. And the Budapest Gambit draws a smile. They don't play that in the World Championships anymore, do they? Dutch part.
Of course, this is out of the ladder. Wil ik nog met een enkel woord u allen bedanken voor de geweldige belangstelling en voor de spontaniteit waarmee u mijn overwinning vergoed heeft. Ik heb op het ogenblik de titel van wereldkampioen behaald. Ik ben er mij van bewust dat dit verplichtingen met zich medebrengt. En naar streven om dat de Alekhine die nu tegen mij verloren heeft, zo spoedig mogelijk in de gelegenheid te stellen zijn revanche te krijgen. En ik hoop dat daartoe heel Nederland zal medewerken. Ik dank u zeer.
Alekhine was very graceful, however, in his concession speech. Gives it in French, I'll translate. So I'm proud and happy that the world of chess has a gentleman as a champion. I'm proud that he is Dutch. I'd like to take this opportunity to issue a challenge against, or a rematch, if you will. And I'd like to say, without being a hypocrite, that if it's not me being a championship, that at least it's a Dutchman being championship, and not Capablanca. So he was somewhat shocked in the loss, but he was at least conciliatory and polite and courteous in his concession speech, which stuck with Owa actually for a long, long time. He later became an advocate of Alekhine when he faced some difficulties, which we'll discuss in a bit. So let me now turn to Warren for our fourth game. This is Alekhine versus Bogolyubov. This was played in Hastings in 1922.
Yeah, this game was actually played on his 30th birthday, so this automatically makes it one of his favorite games. This game also kind of showcased some of his bias and his analysis, or polarization. So he's black. So I don't know where this game was played.
Hastings,
that's right. But he did like the Dutch defense during this period. I don't know if he intentionally wanted to create complications or if it was just his preference, but here he writes, like, already he thinks black is almost close to equalizing, which is pretty ridiculous. Oh yeah, the sound is still on. Yeah, Kasparov kind of bashes his analysis of his own game here. So after bishop d2 takes, he just passes on knight takes d2. Like, Kasparov points out that queen takes d2 is obviously much better, and he's definitely right. The idea is that you want to put the knight on c3, it just controls the center more. It's just not necessary to place yourself so passively. So anyway, that's first point where he gets kind of overambitious with his analysis. And here already he says that black already has like a very nice position. He doesn't say advantage or winning, but you can tell he's already thinking black is doing quite well. Kasparov points out that white still has a definite advantage after d5, actually. For example, knight a5, just queen c3, and white just has a really easy position going here. So he was really biased by the results of the game, like his viewpoint of this opening for black. But anyway, we'll forgive Bogo for not playing actively. One of the moves he missed here is just e5. He probably just did not see that he cannot take on twice because of his knight on d2 that hangs. So black already is probably equal after queen c3. So as is typical in the Dutch, we see this queen e8 h5 maneuver, just trying to launch a barbaric attack, if you will, against white king, like knight g4, checkmate, something like that, right? Doesn't work in this game, but it scares them enough anyway. So white does manage to repulse black's first attack, but black still has a pretty pleasant position. And d5 is a very strong move. The point here is to try to achieve a blockade on the light squares of sorts. You don't want to allow white to play d5 in this sort of position, just because then it gives white at least one possible square for the knight on d4. So for example, if black tries to achieve g5 somehow, I don't know, say a move like knight h7, it's just not that good. White can play d5, and then say for example b4, and white can actually try to hope to activate these pieces. So you really don't want to allow that here. So d5 is a nice point. So we see this pendulum action. He just goes right back to c6 after a4. Alekhine probably had no reserve moving the knight back and forth like this. Some players might actually feel ridiculous moving the same piece twice. I think nowadays there'll probably be less reservation, but it does feel a little bit ridiculous to move a piece back and forth. And bishop h1 may look kind of depressing, but his idea was to try to put the rook on g2 and maybe somehow achieve g4. He's just trying to free his position since queenside is obviously not where he's going to find much play. And now queen e8 is a pretty awesome move. This kind of reminds me of Nimzovic a little bit, achieving a dominance on one wing and then swinging back around to attack the other. Like queen e8 is a really hard move to find. It would not come naturally to me. Most players, including myself, would probably be trying to figure out how to achieve his g5 break. But he saw it deeper. He realized that these queenside pawns were quite weak and that he could take advantage of this. So this move is just very nice. Attacks a4. It's very simple, but it's very strong. So white again is trying to achieve g4. It's really hard to suggest much of else anything already. If, for example, c5, black can just play b5. And again, try to soften up this queen side over here. So it's already a difficult situation. Obviously, white doesn't want to take on d5 because then black gets a beautiful outpost for this knight. So he's still trying to get this d5 square for the knight. That's what the point of b5 is. And, okay, here's where things get interesting. So, all rook takes a8 is almost forced for white. If you play a move like queen a1, then black simply takes and then trades queens, and white has very little in the way of resistance at this point. So, rook takes a8 was pretty much forced for white. And here, Kasparov kind of points out that he could have easily just taken I8 and achieved a winning position still. Alekhine convinced himself somehow that this is not good enough for black, but Kasparov thinks he was basically just trying to create a brilliancy for the sake of it. He's probably right, but it created an interesting game for us, so he just took on c3 instead. It looks pretty crazy at first, since you're giving up a lot of material. So rook takes, and here he has a pretty move, which it may be obvious to you, but it's still interesting.
C2.
Yeah, c2. Yeah. Yeah, so this is a pretty... This is one of the first occurrences of this tactic that I remember seeing in chess, but nowadays it's somewhat common, right? If you try trying to queen a pawn and you attack something with it and move it to the seventh. So the point is that black's threatening two different ways of queening, and he cannot defend against both. Now, actually, Kasparov used a similar tactic in a game with Karpov later on, in kind of a similar situation. White's tied down, but this is a pretty unique tactic. So unfortunately for white, black's going to get a queen. So this is kind of a funny position here, I think. He's actually threatening checkmate in one, right? Yeah, knight f3 mate is a threat. So unfortunately for white, there's not much choice. Has to move the rook. And he finishes off quite elegantly. So bishop b5 kind of forces white hand, because if knight d2, then just queen c1, it's pretty devastating. So unfortunately, white has to sacrifice that rook. And white's position is pretty depressing here. The finish is fun, though. So instead of just taking on f5, he activates the queen. So this ties down knight in f1 and makes things difficult. Now, white can't really move the knight much either, because if knight g4, black can simply take the knight with the exact same tactic that if white takes on e2, black takes back, and again, we have this queen. So unfortunately, white is stuck resorting to just moving pawns forward. The finish is kind of quaint. Alekhine just moves his king back and forth, just kind of demonstrating a point. He didn't have to do this, obviously, but he's just kind of shoving it in his opponent's face. Ah, you can't do anything. Yeah. Not really much to suggest. He's just kind of giving away pawns. And now he played another pretty move. You might find it based on the theme of what he's already played. Yeah. 22, yeah. Yet again, showing this weird tactic. I've never seen the same tactic occur so many times in one game, but yeah, it makes it interesting. So he took, and then he's left in this hopeless endgame, which he resigned to. But yeah, so I think Alekhine doubly liked this game because it was on his birthday. I don't remember what exactly what he said, but I think he said something along the lines of, this was the best birthday gift he ever got. A brilliancy from the gods.
All right, guys, we have a bit to go, and we're going to go a little long, so I understand if you need to head out a bit early. But that was played in Hastings 1922. Hastings hosted a tournament in 1936, actually, which Alekhine did not win, and his performance there was not as dominant as it had been in 30 and 31. And that was actually the first time Alekhine played Capablanca again, after their World Championship Series. And then after that, the next major event was in 1937, when we have a rematch between Alekhine and Owe, and again played in the Netherlands. This time Alekhine had to raise the money to make this match happen. And what's surprising is Alekhine came in really prepared, really motivated, and he crushed Owe. He won 10 wins, 4 losses, 11 draws, just ran away with it. Unfortunately, this was the last time a World Championship match was held until 1948, because shortly afterward, before we could have any more World Championship matches occur, we had World War II. The Germans invaded Paris, occupied Paris. At the time, Alekhine was he was almost 50 years old. He volunteered for the French army as a French citizen, And once Paris fell to the Nazis, he surrendered. And after that, Alekhine had kind of a confused relationship with the with the Third Reich that we'll get to. But I want to point out something pretty interesting from this propaganda poster, which is the German propaganda against Bolshevism. We see that in the cartoon there. Now, Alekhine was strongly anti-Bolshevik. You may imagine they killed his father. They seized his estates worth the equivalent of millions of rubles, which at the time was a huge fortune. Even now it'd be a huge fortune. And they were the impetus for Alekhine's flight. They almost killed him. His immigration to Paris was because of the Bolsheviks. And Alekhine had come out after he won the world championship in 1927 against the Bolshevik regime, and it was a line he repeated several times, saying that they were doomed to fail. And this caused, as you may imagine, a very contentious relationship between the Russian, or former Russian, chess prodigy Alekhine and his former country. And so later on, when Alekhine was looking to challenge some of the strong young Russian players like Botvinnik and Karas and Smyslov, he wasn't able to participate in the Russian tournaments because he was not allowed in the country. They basically said, you're out, we want nothing more to deal with you. And his brother actually disowned him and said, you know, I never want to see you again, or said publicly, I never want to see him again in my life, never going to communicate with him ever again. And that was probably politically motivated, actually. Incidentally, Alekhine, his brother, was murdered in 1939 as well, as a spat involving a mistress. And so one more tragedy to add. Now, when the Nazis occupied Paris and on all of France, really, they confiscated, yeah, she's old and she, and the cats, right? The Nazis confiscated the castle that Alekhine's wife owned, which is called La Châtelaine, and it's in Normandy. Incidentally, it still exists, and if you'd like to stay there, you can, and they have rooms named after chess pieces, and then the best suite is the Alekhine suite. It was, according to Alekhine, it was scientifically looted by the Nazis, and this was traumatic for both Alekhine and his wife. They seized their assets, confiscated all their stuff, including their property, denied them both exit visas, and Grace, being an American, was stuck in France, and Alekhine couldn't get out of the country, Grace couldn't get out of the country, and Alekhine agreed to play nice with the Nazi regime in exchange for favorable treatment for him and his wife. And so in March of 1941, a series of articles appeared in the Pariser Zeitung, which was a German newspaper in Nazi-controlled Paris. So with Alekhine's name attached to them, which was talking about Jewish chess versus Aryan chess, and talking about how noble Aryan chess was and how Jewish chess was solid, but it was not truly art like Aryan chess was, because Aryan chess was attacking chess and Jewish chess was defensive chess. They were just trying to save draws while Aryans were playing to win. You know, so saying that Jews were inferior chess players, essentially, and that, you know, they weren't in it for the passion, they were in it for the money. So these were, you know, ethnic stereotypes that resonated at the time. And the question is authorship. Was it had Alekhine's name on it, and he didn't do anything to deny the reports or the articles immediately. But after the war, he did. He said, you know, as soon as Paris was liberated in 1944, he disavowed association with the articles. But what's interesting is he did it in different and inconsistent ways. At first, he said, I wrote scientific articles and they completely changed it into Nazi propaganda. And then he said, I didn't write a word of that. Those two are inconsistent. And I think that the truth is probably closer to the former case, that it was probably written by Alekhine and that it was probably edited by the editor, or the chess editor for the Zeitung, who was a fairly strong chess player in his own right and a rabid anti-Semite. And we knew, or the chess community knew, that Alekhine was somewhat anti-Semitic. He made remarks all throughout his career that was somewhat disparaging to Jews. Like when he lost in 1935, he blamed it in part on the referee of the match, which was Hans Kmoke, because Kmoke's wife was Jewish, and you know, so obviously Kmoke had it in for him. And this is the guy who was Alekhine's second at, you know, his 1929 title defense. So, and this is according to Kmoke, by the way. He made some remarks then, and Tartakower remarked that, you know, we've known he's an anti-Semite for 15 years, and we haven't said anything for this, you know, amount of time, so why are we making such a big deal about it now? But after the war, he vehemently denied that he was anti-Semitic, and he was kind of put on trial by the chess players at the time, which we'll kind of get to. So we can't say for sure to what extent these articles were modified or not modified from Alekhine's intention. But his journal enters the public domain in 2019. That's when in French law it becomes part of the public domain. So then his journal, which was quite detailed and apparently had handwritten versions of these articles, will give us some insight. But we won't know that for a while yet. It's interesting to know that Grace, his fourth wife, was Jewish, at least by birth. So we're unclear how truly anti-Semitic he was. Probably not as vitriolic as we saw in the articles, that's for sure. Now, he did play nice with the Nazis. He kind of had to. Remember Hans Frank, the butcher of Poland? We talked about him at the Nemcevich lecture. Well, he's back, and he was the one who got favorable treatment for Alekhine in exchange for Alekhine's participation in tournaments in Nazi-occupied Europe. So Alekhine toured around German-held cities, played in tournaments from 1941 to 1943. There you see him together. Hans Frank was the governor of Poland at the time. There's evidence Alekhine lived with him in Poland for a while, and at least until 1943, when he made his way back to France and then on to Spain. And then Hans Frank, as we discussed last time, was hung after the Nuremberg trials. So there, Alekhine was playing essentially to eat. He had a rations card like everybody else, and that's the only way he could go and actually get food, was to keep, you know, playing nice and schmoozing with the Nazi elite, including like Joseph Goebbels, the Minister of Propaganda. So he played nice, trying to get favorable treatment for himself and for his wife. It didn't work. He did not obtain an exit visa for his wife. And then before we get to the very, very end of Alekhine's life, let's look at one other game that he played. This is versus Samish. Poor Samish, he's getting beat up on 2 months in a row. And this was a blindfold match, important to note.
Sorry. Yeah, this is pretty amusing. Oh, yeah. When I first saw this game, I didn't realize it was blindfold, actually. Kasparov didn't mention it in his book on these games, and I didn't realize it was blindfold until I looked at Alekhine's book, where he mentions this is a blindfold exhibition game. I was like, wow, and had a lot more respect after that for this.
Yeah, chessgames.com entitles this one Shot in the Dark.
Yeah. Oh, that's clever. Yeah, so the opening was a bit unorthodox, but at the time they didn't really have too much in the way of theory on the Sicilian anyway. So there is an interesting point here. So he plays bishop f3. Most everybody nowadays would look at this move and go, huh? It's kind of strange. And one of the reasons for that is that black can play this move knight e5. And but Alekhine is unfazed by this. Now, I would personally hate this because you're going to have to give up that bishop on f3. And I would not want to give up a bishop without like some decent reason. But Alekhine had no such reservations. His whole point was just be able to play this move, c4, and achieve this bind. So again, this kind of plays into his unbiased, kind of concrete view of looking at things. Now I see someone in the audience looking strangely at this move, so black cannot take this pawn because white can check. So the pawn is immune. But anyway, this kind of shows how he looked at chess so much differently than most people did and even do now. You know, he didn't care that he was losing a bishop. He cared about the bind and having space. To him, that was more relevant in terms of quality of position. Anyway, So he just has a really simple development of pieces. Black is still doing okay, although here he kind of goes astray. So b6 is his definite mistake here. He had to play something else, like, for example, knight of 8 was fine. B6 just weakens the c6 square, and that turns out to be a pretty critical point. So f5, moving forward. And now in a blindfold game, he comes up with this ridiculous idea of just taking e6. Of course, right? Yeah, it just gives it up for a piece like it's nothing. And now this devastating move here. And remarkably, Black's queen has 4 squares it can go to. Every single one of them loses. Now the main point in all of these lines is that White plays knight e6, threatening mate on g7. And that's the common theme. And I'll go over the variations that he gives. They're pretty amusing. So for example, if queen b7, then knight e6, bishop e5, just takes d8. And White's already threatening mate. So it's pretty irresistible. And the queen is hanging as well. So queen b7 loses. For example, a more interesting one is queen a7. White has knight c6. Bishop e5. Bishop takes. D takes. Knight takes. Rook takes. And White wins nicely with rook takes d7. One point is that if rook f8, White can take on a7, but even simpler is rook d8.
Oh.
That's just a fun tactic. Yeah, so that's one fun line. I'll just give one more. So another interesting one is queen b8. White wins by knight c6. Bishop e5, takes, knight takes, and knight c7. This pretty move here. Rook f8, knight e6, and rook d8. And this bishop is just perpetually pinned, so it's pretty much hopeless. Actually, I'll give this one last one because it's kind of a cool move at the end. And finally, if Black plays queen c5, then we have knight e6, bishop e5, takes, and then see if you can find the killer move here. Yeah, 98. The idea is that you're going to queen, and Black can't move the knight because the rook hangs. So, yeah, that's a pretty fun variation. And, of course, he saw all this blindfolded. Samish actually resigned after he played knight d5. He didn't even want to bother. Apparently, he was so demoralized by this that every game after he played Alekhine, he just lost. He could not face this guy anymore. Yeah, so that was just a cool game.
All right, so in 1943, Alekhine gets out. The war is going very poorly for the Nazis. The Allied forces have made advances in Italy. They have essentially eliminated the Italians from the Axis. They have made gains in the Pacific. They are bombing Germany relentlessly. Germany is losing on the Eastern Front as the Russian army advances, and Alekhine realizes that it's time to get the heck out. So he gets his opportunity when he accepts a tournament invitation in 1943 to play. It's in October 1943, and he never left again, or he stayed in Spain or Portugal for the remainder of his life. Now, he hoped to get Grace to join him in Spain or Portugal and then to defect or to get out and go to the United States with his American wife. However, he was thwarted by American officials because of the articles that had appeared in the Nazi newspapers under his name. They refused to issue him a visa because of the anti-Semitic articles. So he essentially burned his bridge with Russia. He burned his bridge with the United States. And we'll see soon that he burned his bridge with France as well. And that left him stuck in Spain or Portugal. Spain was a neutral country in World War II, so at least he was relatively safe there. While he was in Spain and working as a technical advisor for a magazine there and basically living in a hotel on the charity of others because he had no real income other than simuls, the Allies seized control of Paris. They liberated Paris, and there was this huge backlash in France against collaborators with the Nazi regime. There were scores settled. There were executions. About 10,000 people were executed in France who had been sympathizers or collaborators with the Nazis. Women who had had relationships with German soldiers had their heads shaved, and they were paraded through the streets, sometimes half nakedly. So there was a lot of public shaming there. And Alekhine knew that if he returned to France, he was going to have to face trial for his articles and his collaboration with the German regime. So he was stuck. He could not make it back safely. So he knew that he was stuck in Spain and Portugal. He gave classes there, did what he could. He didn't see his wife really again. She was stuck in France and he was stuck in Spain and Portugal. She really didn't want to have much more to do with him. And he was on a great decline. He was drinking a lot. He had gone to see a doctor, and the doctor found that his liver was swollen to almost equal with his right nipple. So his liver was huge. He had very advanced cirrhosis, 2 minor heart attacks, and couldn't play chess. He was invited to London to participate in a tournament there in 1946, but then the USCF, the nascent US Chess Federation, threatened to boycott because of his anti-Semitic articles. So the tournament in London actually retracted his invitation. So he couldn't get out, couldn't play, they were trying to organize a match with Botvinnik for the World Championship, with the Russian Chess Federation offering to pay, and that couldn't happen either. And in 1946, he died. This is the morning of March 24th, 1946. This photo was taken of Alekhine in a hotel room in Portugal, in Estoril, Portugal. Now, when his death was first reported, there was quite a bit of controversy around it. First, the autopsy said that he choked on a piece of meat. There was a piece of meat lodged in his larynx. And the coroner's report, which we'll see on the next slide, discusses that. However, you might expect there to be some disturbance of his plates. You know, if he was choking, wouldn't he struggle? Wouldn't he knock over a table, something? Then there was report that he died of a heart attack, but again, we see no signs of struggle. And then people point out, where's the silverware? There's no silverware on the table. That's kind of odd. So people thought that maybe this photo looks staged. There's the coroner's report written in English by Dr. Ferreira. Ferreira actually initially said that he died of choking, but then he said that he had been forced to write that by the Portuguese secret police, and that actually Alekhine had been died from a gunshot wound, and that the Portuguese secret police staged him in his room to make it look like natural causes. And theories on this one go both ways. Alekhine's son, Alexander III, thinks that Moscow had a hand in assassinating Alekhine. Some people have purported that the elements of the French resistance may have assassinated him as a former collaborator, as there were Nazi hunters traveling all over the world to find former members of the Nazi regime to bring them to justice or to just assassinate them. So it's really unclear. My take on it is that the simplest solution is probably the best. He had had two heart attacks. He was in very poor health. I could easily imagine him dying of a massive heart attack. I mean, I don't know that there's any reason to look much further than that. A doctor had said he had a year or less to live, and that was 11 months before he actually died. So even if he was assassinated, he wasn't long for the world because his alcoholism and his health had just declined to a very poor state. Now, he was buried originally in Portugal. The Portuguese Chess Federation took his remains, buried him in a cemetery. About 10 people attended his funeral. He was world champion, but a forgotten one. In 1956, his wife Grace successfully lobbied FIDE, which existed at this time, to transfer his remains to Paris. So he was buried at Montparnasse Cemetery. So you can go visit his grave. However, in the mid-90s, there was a windstorm that blew over the grave and it was restored. And maybe you can find out what they did wrong with his grave site. I'm sorry?
Why not right?
Yeah, the chessboard was rotated 90 degrees. So you could still find his grave, but with the board rotated in the wrong direction. Anyway, for this presentation, I used quite a few books, some in various respects. I found all of them had somewhat of a bias that I really had to sort through to try to figure out what the actual truth was. And sometimes I've given you my opinion and not necessarily the opinion of these authors. And then if you're interested, I've got all my images cited as well. And I'll be glad to send this so you can find all the images, and there are tons. And certainly open any questions you might have.
There were some instances where William Fine wanted to add, was denying a match with Alekhine.
Yeah, Alekhine actually predicted in the 1930s that Reuben Fine would be the next world champion, which some people found to be proof that Alekhine was not an anti-Semite because Fine was Jewish. And another strong supporter of Alekhine was actually Arnold Dinker. Alekhine had taken him out to dinner several times when he visited New York. And so Dinker was an advocate for him when the USCF was discussing boycotting the 1946 London tournament. Alekhine respected him as a player, but actually Alekhine, toward the end of his life, predicted that Smyslov was going to be world champion. He saw a very strong talent in his games. So there was talk of him playing Fine. There was talk of him playing Botvinnik. In the end, after Alekhine died, FIDE organized a tournament, which Botvinnik won fairly handily to become world champion in 1948. I don't think Reuben Fine ever was world champion.
No.
No.
World War II, we never had a chance.
Mm.
Is there any truth to the rumors that Alekhine, challenged God with a porn handicap?
That he challenged what? I'm sorry?
God. He gave God a porn handicap.
I hadn't heard that anecdote, but I wouldn't put it past him. Alekhine religiously was brought up Orthodox, as everyone in Russia was at the time. In the 1920s in Paris, he joined a Masonic temple, actually, two different Masonic temples in Paris, and he was a member, but mostly it was for the camaraderie and not necessarily the mysticism. The evidence really says that he was probably a believer like most people of that time period, but he was not necessarily diligent in his faith. So I'm not sure if he would have gone so far as to blaspheme that to that extent, but I wouldn't put it past him. Yeah. Yep.
I heard or read somewhere that sometime in there, like 1935 to 1937, they really sobered up quite a bit.
So the reports on that vary. Some say that between 1935, when he was smashed drunk and to Uwe, for at least half of the length of the match, that he made a resolution to stop drinking, and that he kept that resolution until the outbreak of World War II, until the occupation of Paris. And there is evidence that for about a 5-year period, yes, he did stop drinking. So it looks like from 1925 to about 1935, he was a definitely an alcoholic, and then he abstained, and then from 1940 to 1946, he perhaps regressed. He was perhaps, worse of an alcoholic. They talk about him taking a bottle of cognac with him at night and then it being empty the next morning, and him showing up to Simul's and tournaments just like sloppy drunk. There's an anecdote of him in 1943, I think it was, castling his queen. He was so drunk. So that was probably the first and last time that a world champion played that move. So he certainly struggled with alcohol quite a bit, and I think he was enabled by his fourth wife. But there is, like you say, there is at least anecdotal remarks that he gave it up for 5 years. I'm not 100% convinced of that, but yeah, that's the theory.
There is a story of, like Kasparov recounts of him during one game in his world championship match with Oyvind. Taking a glass, a pitcher of orange juice to the game, being sober, and they both enjoyed a nice refreshing glass of it and had a quick draw, and everyone was happy. So apparently he had one day sober in his match against the Oyvind.
Doesn't Carlson drink a lot of orange juice?
Yeah, it's funny how that works.
Interesting.
See a correlation.
Yeah, yeah. 2 points make a line. Anything else, guys? Okay, well, you're certainly welcome to peruse the books I brought with me and that I used, or hang around with any questions you might have. Okay.